Next week, Monday, we have an appointment with Mana. Mana is an entity of people who have a dream. And they are very intelligent. They explored and they came up with a machine, which is actually a kind of a box. What you do, you shovel in sand. The box separates the aluminium and the silicium and the rest. And then it starts 3D printing, and it 3D prints a solar panel. So what they come up with is the step from sand to solar panel. This is not because they have this big idea how they can make money in the energy industry. They have a dream. They want to go to Mars. And then you have a completely different problem. Then you want energy production on a planet where there isn't, and you need the means to go with your rocket to the planet. In my daily life, I work for a grid operator. And for us, this is hell and heaven at the same time. Because what is our dream? Our dream is that everybody has energy and will continue to have energy. That's great, because if you only need sand to get energy, and raw energy is abundant, that's the dream. It's also hell, because we have a lock-in on energy cables. And that means that people who have very economic minds now can start creating energy where we absolutely do not need it, so they can bring the grid to the level that it breaks down, and we would be forced to pay a maximum amount of money to keep the system running. What we are doing in this challenge is asking big questions to redesign the world. This, for me, is an example how our system of today is very brittle. What we see is that if people look differently, there's already a lot of technology who can do crazy things. But how can we combine those things to work in ecosystems that are beneficial for all? That's what we want to do in our challenge. If you look at our logo, then you have the caterpillar and the butterfly. People who know us from the last years know that we go for the crazy. Disruption before it happens is always an unimaginable crazy story. As soon as it happens, it gets normal. So from the perspective of a caterpillar, imagining that you can fly is crazy. The best thing you can do is jump, and if you're on a branch of a tree, that's very dangerous. In the case of the butterfly, we know this transition is there. But it's not only the crazy dream of flying, it's also losing the butterfly, the caterpillar. So the systems of tomorrow ceased to be a caterpillar. That's what makes our solution, our track, very hard. Because we are going to challenge the teams of rethinking how their solutions work. If they are viable in our current narratives, in our current economies, in our solutions where everything is or is seen as a business, where every value exchange is, I give you this and then you give me that, then we are still, to some extent, at caterpillar level. If we look of how situations could work. Then we have those situations that work, and we do not even notice that they are working. Like breathing. In the Netherlands, I do not think about breathing. But of course, if we pollute the air, like in other places of the earth, then it becomes hard to breathe. And at that moment, there is a business case, because there is a conflict. And normally we like conflicts, because conflicts invite for systems of control and for abilities to make money. In this challenge, we want you to rethink that. We're going to work with you to rethink that. And the good news is, we are doing this for the third time, so we also experience some things. In the places where we do not look for solutions in our blind spots, there are possibilities. And if you have a purpose-driven dream, and you are looking in those blind spots, you will find solutions that are unimaginable. And the great thing is, because it is in those blind spots that those solutions have the same building blocks. And people will be able to cooperate and co-create. So what we are inviting is 10 teams to go on a crazy exploration, to discover the unimaginable and discover how you can build it, but also the growing of how do I lose the caterpillar in myself? How do I feel that energy? What are the elements that stay the same so that the caterpillar at the end becomes a butterfly? So what we are going to do is ask you what is your purpose-driven dream and discuss how we can engineer it. How do we can make it a system that could be operated anywhere on Earth? And the only challenge that we have then is that we have to ensure that it works, that it functions. We are going to free you from the second requirement that's normally always there, that you have to make money, that you have to make a business case. So what we are working on are resilient ecosystems. What we are not working on are profitable systems. What we are not working on are cost-efficient systems, because cost-efficient systems are very brittle. Ecosystems can be anti-fragile, so there are a lot of avenues of exploration we want to explore with you in advance to give you a completely new perspective of what we can do. So, we have the period until the hackathon, and that's the preparation phase. And we are tough during the preparation phase. If you're one of our 10 teams, you have to put in some work. Then, during the hackathon, we have a whole support team, also here, but also here to help you to make a very successful proof of concept. And what we're going to do this year is to explore an avenue of acceleration. That's not so typical, but it is our vision on how you can accelerate not businesses, but ecosystems. The seven steps is one way to climb this unimaginable mountain. It is helping you to reframe and reframe the way you are looking, to look at all those things you deem normal but are actually crazy, to iterate and iterate so that at the 2nd of April you have a completely different understanding of the problem and the technology possibilities that are there, but also how can you interact with human, how can you create systems that work, that people really like. To give you an example, I want to take you to the solution and that the winners of 2018 built. What they did from a technological perspective is they just took a blockchain and they made every node a drone and combined it to a hive mind. This they did to create a proof of concept where people who would be lost in a forest are found by the drones and are shown out. But the narrative behind it, with which they pitched it, was much bigger and more impressive. They say, we look at the world and we see basically everything happening. That means that we see people in distress. What if we use these kind of technologies to create an ecosystem of machines interacting with machines who could help those people to build a kind of a refugee camp that could work? Because now we have people in distress. We gather $100,000, $200,000, $500,000 dollars or euro. We help the people and the money is gone. But from the digital place, from the digital twin side of things, we could build a service that's continuously there. Then we can start to think of how could those machines interact so that we use this money not for one disaster and it's gone, but to create ecosystems where the machines help the people. And the second path where it brought us to some crazy thinking is that they pointed out that a refugee camp or a military camp or a festival is basically a city that exists for a very short period of time. So you have an infrastructure of almost nothing. Then you build an infrastructure. And then 10,000 people live for it for 5 days, and then it's gone. If you're thinking about, okay, what is the future of cities, then we always think of cities that are stuck in one place. But if those festivals would evolve, get more mature, an ecosystem where every innovation in the festival is automatically open source shared with all the other festivals of the world, for free, then you can create a community who builds the future of humanity in the form of moving cities. If you go to our colleagues of The Hague and you ask them how would you like the city if it starts moving, then for them it's a crazy thought. And for us it's just festivals 2.0. The great thing for the winning team also was that their work on a hive mind was so new that they published a paper together with MIT. So exploring these kind of crazy paths, getting your mind freed and open up to think radical new things, can really help build innovations that were unimaginable at first, but you here find the space to build it. Last year, we had 6.5 hours to explain Nature 2.0. This year, we have 45 minutes. So we wanted to help you that it is more than normal that if you hear the 45 minutes pitch, it's very hard to grasp what we are saying. The only thing we want to achieve today is that you get a kind of feeling that I don't fully grasp what's happening, but it could be working, because then it's nice to interact and to get some common understanding. What is your purpose-driven dream? How would you build, like to build your own ecosystem? And we can show the parallels of what we are doing and how we think in the end that it can be an ecosystem of ecosystems that work.
I'm waiting for it. Yeah, it's on. We did a session already, and then my microphone was on and off, so I was really looking like, okay, can I start talk now? But again, let me first introduce myself, because you probably all know Jan-Peter from last year's, or because he was on stage. But I'm actually quite new to Nature 2.0, so my name is Carlijn. And I'm also helping, and I'm not going to tell you technical stuff. I'm just going to ask you some questions now, because we're also interested in how you feel and what your feeling is after listening to Jan-Peter for now. And the unimaginable but buildable. I first want to start with another question. And I want you all to stand up. If you want to make the world a better place, or if you want to see the world as a better place. I'm so happy everybody's going to stand now. So everybody wants to see the world as a better place. So that's nice. And could you please stay standing if you have a purpose-driven dream? Ooh, everybody's still standing. That's nice. And now there comes another part, because you all have this purpose-driven dream, but you probably also have big hurdles in your purpose-driven dream, because otherwise it wouldn't be a dream, right? Then you probably already would have realized it. And in somehow, some way, this hurdle makes it feel like your purpose-driven dream maybe is a little bit unimaginable that it would be realizable. So who wants to share their purpose-driven dream and the big hurdle they have, why it's not realized yet? Oh, I already see somebody get seated.
I see a hand.
Yeah.
Hidden in the back, but
I'm sort of standing, huh? Now, my problem is gravity. That's why I'm lying like this. And I a few months ago, I gave a presentation on space exploration. I studied astronomy years ago. And I presented that in 15 years from now, I will immigrate to space. And we will build settlements over there. I'll show you my presentation.
Okay, cool. But what is your biggest hurdle? Is it just time then, your hurdle?
My hurdle is gravity. Okay. And my other hurdle is time. I always find lots of things interesting and I never have enough time.
Okay, well, that's clear. Is there somebody else?
Anyone else?
Oh, yeah.
My name is Jeroen Nijkamp. I'm a UX designer student here in the Haagse Hogeschool. And I have a dream that we can live in a society that could exist without money in any way, shape, or form. But yeah, as you can imagine, there's a lot of hurdles to this kind of an idea. And one of the hurdles is, you know, you can't do that, or the world doesn't work like that, and stuff like that. But in the context of what we heard today and the presentation this morning, I'm done with going the wrong direction slowly, and I'm ready to turn around and go the right direction.
Woo-hoo! Yeah.
Didn't you do a presentation on that last year here on the Haagse Hogeschool? Yeah, I think I saw you there.
Somebody else who wants to and share?
It's our third session, so let's make some fun. Let's give things that are really, really hard.
No, it's your turn.
Hi. So I'm a legal consultant, and I worked with startup for the past 4 years. And I recently had I felt quite disillusioned about the fact that we all talking about innovation and about like changing the world, and we're not able. And I've been drafting NDAs and stuff to make people collaborate, but there was always the wrong step. There is this struggle of really global collaboration, and every time there was a partnership to be made, it was like, how is the other guy gonna screw me over? And we see the collaboration is not just failing in science and innovation, but also in when we want to really kind of merge different industries together. We don't trust science, we don't trust innovation, we don't trust the government to take action. So my dream would be to, well, kind of like build tools, and I come from legal, so there's going to be a challenge, but to create trust through legal means and collaborative means, because that's the only way we can create really a better world with global challenges.
Oh, really nice. So we can co-create together instead of competition.
And I got a well, you ladies first, and then we come get to you. Yeah.
Thank you. My name is Saskia. I'm with Biomimicry Netherlands. So we look to nature for inspiration for sustainable innovation. I think my dream is that we learn to become a well-adapted species on this planet. That is our home, but not ours alone. So that we move from human-centered to life-centered design. And I think the driver for me in that is how can we make asking nature for advice as part of everyday inventing. And I hope I will be living long enough to see that happening. So I think a big hurdle is time, but also some mental models that many of us have. And what you well said on stage, that we are sort of, we think there's this separation between us humans and the rest of the natural world. So.
Okay, you got a question here on this side of the room.
My name is Patrick Jansen. I've been working for a long time in IT supporting organizations. And I've been on a world trip together with my family, 3 kids, my wife last year. It was a big experience. And my dream is that my kids can live in a world where they can always travel and always enjoy nature, other cultures, other countries, and not doing in a way that they have to deregister from their government and if they come back, register again. And beside that, I see that all the resources and draining of resources. It would be very nice if the boundaries of going abroad and to meet other people and countries, if the boundaries will be lowered. I don't know how, but yeah, that's my dream. If that can come true, then it will also be possible for people with no money. So that's my dream.
Thank you.
And the VR glasses are not a solution, I suppose. Mm. Got a question on the other side of the room. A question, a statement.
Thank you very much. I'm Kenrick. I'm now a third year student in communication science from the University of Twente. And I'm really inspired by Enactus. Enactus is a real world organization that enables students to be responsible leaders. And I'm really wanting to help also students give the opportunities to empower and inspire other people. That's really what I really like to do. So I'm starting now in Enactus Twente. But what I really find difficult is, especially regarding finding a real core problem of some certain areas. So for example, if you look at Tom's Shoes as a company, they provided free shoes to children in Africa. But after research is done, they found out that this was not the right solution because these children didn't actually need these shoes and they ruined their whole economy because the shoes were available, but they gave now free shoes to children, so nobody bought new shoes there. So I found it really difficult to do this kind of needs assessment, what is really needed, and find the real core problem of a certain aspect of in the world.
Well, that's a very well thought hurdle you were describing there. Like, I want to do it, but
slowly,
how do I do it?
Slowly, now everybody's sitting again, yeah. But I see two still standing.
Last man standing. Yeah. Okay. My mission is sort of a. I'm always wondering something. When I was a little bit younger, I'm not so old, but when I was a little bit younger, I watched the National Geographic and I saw a movie of elephants. And what puzzled me was that elephants always know their way to water, even if the whole group hasn't been there. And today I heard a lot of talking about understanding each other, sharing knowledge, complexity, and a thing called a collective intelligence. And I'm wondering if there's such a thing as collective intelligence. Because if knowledge is always owned by someone, it's never available to us all. So collective intelligence is my wonder. And I don't know how to get there, but I heard that doesn't matter.
No, it can be unimaginable, but still buildable.
Hi, everyone. My name is Rick. I see a world where people collaborate through middlemen, and I dream of a world where everybody truly works peer-to-peer and together, and most of all economically work together. And therefore, I intend to build an ecosystem of ecosystems, and my biggest hurdle is that people don't understand me. So therefore, I'm working on my communication, and so I'm trying to sell, not just sell, because it's a free and open source ecosystem, but I'm trying to figure out how we are going to build this together.
Thank you.
Yeah, yeah, well, you're sitting again, but I saw you standing.
Perhaps not not fully determined and clear, but I still have a dream. In principle, people want to help each other as a standard feeling. That's also when I hear you talking, I get inspired with you. And on the other hand, we become selfish, lonely, and dominated by a few people. And how would it be if people could help each other, as they would normally do if they know each other more better? That would be my dream.
Thank you. I'm quite impressed by the many dreams we hear.
One more.
Yeah.
Last one.
Yeah. My name is Kabir. So first of all, I wanted to say that collective intelligence exists. We have to unlock it. And there are many questions for this, but now the direction that I'm thinking about is, I think it kind of a little bit sort of puts on a more general level things that were already told, is in our lives, let's say 90% of our time we spend by maintaining ourselves. And then 10%, maybe if we're lucky, we spend to create something. So the direction that I'm thinking is how to kind of change the proportion. It's not realistic to think that we can spend 100% of our time just playing around and creating, but how to kind of gradually go to the 90% of creation and 10% of maintenance. And then I had a question for the legal consultant. Blockchain, which was a kind of a beginning of the Odyssey, as far as I understand, the idea is that how do we create trustless communities where trust is not important? How does it connect to what you say? Basically, that's a kind of open question, let's say. You don't need to answer it now, but that's the question that I've
read
to myself when you said
it. Do you think it's okay if you talk it up? Because we want to tell you more, and we just have 15 more minutes. So.
Yeah, let's continue the presentation, and there's plenty of time to talk further during the day.
Yeah, because then you can like have a normal, deep conversation with one another. And you might think, why are you asking us this? And actually, I'm really happy that so many people start telling their dreams. And there are so many beautiful dreams in this room. And this is because by asking you, we just wanted to see and show, hey, it can be buildable. And all these things you're saying, let's just work on it. Let's build it. And I think that you can like tell us more about it, right?
The super cool thing is that every problem you just mentioned, there is already a solution lying if you start questioning what you normally do. So one of the things we heard, I don't have time. But a lot of the decisions you have to make is because you're part of a business model of somebody else. I just want working energy. And I have to think about contracts, about metering. I just want it to work. I don't need to pay for it. I just want it to work. When I'm 11, as I was 11 years old, I had those two big entities called mom and dad, and they ensured that my world worked. They ensured that I had a house, that the house was warm, that there was something to eat, all the things I didn't care about. We are coming into the age of machines interacting with machines. So the fact that there are problems that have to be solved to make it a working ecosystem doesn't mean that it has to be a business that does it. what we are challenging the 10 teams in to become the people who have such big dreams that they solve it for all of the people. You said, I don't know if this collective intelligence is there. Of course, Kabir reacted. He's one of the guys who works with Ben Gurtzel on artificial general intelligence. If you go hundreds of years back, then you had the spirits of old that people connected to, having a kind of a spiritual link to him, thinking that that would help. We are now coming into an age where there will be a second species that can think in concepts. The stories that they tell will be in the air everywhere. The way we are going to develop artificial intelligence is going to determine how it will talk to us. In the world of today, that means where there's funding, that's the guys who learn the AI to talk, but it's normally business or fighting. Business is how can I trick the people into buying stuff they do not need? Or how can I create magnitude systems of control? Where we as humans also know friendship, where we care about each other, we connect and we have the art of giving. And this is also a way to operate. And how this can be a valid ecosystem, that's what I want to show you, because that's the basically the what we want to share with you. For this challenge, we teamed up with four critical infrastructures, and we all have the problem that if we co-create with businesses, there's always some kind of a balance, because somewhere in the ecosystem, there's a problem we do not solve, but we make a business model around fighting the symptoms, which makes our critical infrastructures brittle. We are looking for new parties who are purpose-driven, that do not have this need of creating control system, creating systems where people are forced to pay. Because we, as a grid operator, we invest $1 billion every year. We depreciate that over 40 years, and we put cables in the ground to transport energy. That means that we have a lock-in for the transportation of energy through cables for the coming 40 years. That's socially accepted, but it is the question if that's the best way to go forward, especially if you now look at cars, self-driving entities with energy bellies, who could be a mobile energy system. If we have groups of people whose dream it is to create mobility systems for the world, then they would be ideal partners, because we would see a combination of creating also energy systems for the world. For us, it would be totally acceptable if energy is free and accessible for everybody, because that's what's in our mission statement. We want people to be insured for energy. That's why we work, that's why we put in the time. Creating radical different solutions could be so nice. So please take this moment to let the other parties introduce themselves.
I would really love it when mobility is helping to improve the commons of water, air, and soil. Now we accept that mobility pollutes these commons, but I would like to change it that when you move, you make air and water and soil better.
So why not think in a different way, act in a different way, and create a future in a different way?
To make a system resilient, it has to be flexible and it has to be nature-based. So it has to be in relationship with the natural environment and the way things work biologically.
We are critical infrastructure, so our goal is to help society.
We have a supportive role for the whole of the environment and for the whole of the society.
We are public organizations, so what we do is for the commons, it's for the people in our country.
We are looking for innovative ways of solving some of very old problems.
It's actually funny because, yeah, we're for different critical infrastructures, but yet we're the same, so we have the same problems and we have the same challenges. And why would you tackle them alone if you can tackle them together?
We are designing and managing public goods.
actually, I think that's the main thing that binds us.
There are parties who claim some of the activities in the critical infrastructure for other purposes than the common good, which is a risk for the government, because it's the role of the government to make sure that all its people have access to clean drinking water, to energy, and to mobility, and to do it in a safe way.
If you don't have energy anymore, you can't use your fridge, you won't have lights, you can't use your cell phone. Well, think about that and after 10 days. That's kind of a critical situation, right? If you don't have it after 10 days.
The unification of this critical infrastructure is important because what we've been doing for the past decades, I guess, is we've been working in pillars. So everybody's been developing their own little expertise to improve and improve and making business models on top of each other. But separate. No ecosystem can function separate, so they have to come together and build the next ecosystem which would be sustainable for the planet.
My dream for the future would be that everyone is provided with everything they need. So all the things that are so critical, that you don't even think about not having roads or not having water or not having electricity or not being safe.
My dream scenario is actually these highways get more functions, so now they're only for mobility, like our highways. But our highways will also move with the demands of the area where that they're crossing. So when the area needs nature, we will deserve more nature. When the area needs more water in a dry area, we will build our infrastructure like it can capture water.
The dream future, that would be a future where all the people live in peace and harmony. But I'm a realist, that's why I work for defense, so not everybody has this mentality. So you have to be prepared, certainly as a government, to prepare for the worst, hoping that you not need to act.
I would really invite you to work in it, to give us inspiration, to build the future together in the Netherlands. But also, not only in our country, but also for the rest of the world, of course.
Follow your inspiration and act upon it, because the world offers you the opportunity right now to do so.
The Odyssey was impressive as it is, but the Nature 2.0 track was special. You could feel it in that group. You could feel it in the whole hall. At the Nature 2.0 track, all energy is just on that focus. We need to make this solution work, and the competition, if I win or lose, we're winning because we're coming up with the next Nature 2.0. So it's the solution of the future.
You're thinking about joining the Odyssey Hackathon. What are you waiting for? Join now. Join Nature 2.0. It's a really great chance and you're going to change the world. So don't hesitate anymore. Just come and applicate.
Let's see whether we can organize something really, really beautiful and worthwhile for new generations and a new future.
So what is this crazy? Why do we believe that if you build your dream, it still would work in the end? It's because we are doing it for the third time now. The first year we asked people to build machine-to-machine ecosystems, because if you build the machines and you design the ecosystem, you decide on the narrative. That can be an economical narrative, but it doesn't have to be. And we had 9 teams who built a commons, and none of them built a business. The year after that, that was the first Nature 2.0 challenge, we said to the teams, okay, look at the 8.7 million other species, get systems without ownership, without identity like we use it, and without money, and ensure, like nature, that it still functions. So go out of the market thinking and go into complex thinking, go into system thinking. And what happened is that we had a problem because Odyssey wanted a winner. And we had a team that started co-creating so heavily that their solutions became interdependent. Because if you are building dreams beneficial for all, you all use the same building blocks because you are giving. you are not fighting about IP, you're not creating a market, you are creating solutions that are resilient in nature, and what you're doing is enhancing resilience. And that means that you are discovering that either other solution is helping you to become more resilient. So what's going to happen in March, we have to plan the date yet, is that we bring the 10 teams together so that they get to know each other. And we bring them together with our critical infrastructure parties, those entities who are looking for new kind of collaboration partners. And then we have the 2 days of magic. And then we are going to explore how this ecosystem of ecosystems is going to work. Because from our perspective, we're working on the research questions that are too big for one critical infrastructure, but essential for us all. And we don't care if the things that make us happy make all the other grid operators in the world happy, or all the other water authorities, or all. So yeah, you can create a community of critical infrastructures who are all big investors and now have a lock-in in the current system to break out of that locking system, to understand how they are no longer the caterpillar in the system. So what we're going to ask the teams is build a commons, an ecosystem towards abundance, or an owner's ecosystem. But as you are experiencing in this 45 minutes, we are asking a lot of your brain power, of your rethink. And that's why we are offering a lot of help in the challenge. So February 24th, we have 10 teams that will be participating in R-Track. You've seen the way how we make videos. All the teams will be helped to build an own ecosystem. We have visual facilitation to come up with new kind of concepts, because complexity in words is tiresome. Complexity in drawing is much, much easier. We will do the iteration and the iteration with you to understand the problems that you're facing much, 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 much better. So that's the Einstein way of working. We don't want you to work on the solution until April 2nd, but you have a completely different perspective of what your starting point is. We offer assistance in research. All those technologies that already exist but are not used, because you cannot force people to pay. We give you insight in numbers, and we help you with getting your narrative together, because we have a TEDx coach. In March, we all come together and we create for the first time the ecosystem, so that you get the common understanding and this feeling of collaboration. Yeah? This is a track that won't have any winners. So again, we're going to hack the Odyssey. April 2nd, we want the best prepared teams, and all the people you met up front are now there for 2 days long to help you accelerate. And of course, the Jedi that you need for technology, the data that you need, we will ensure that we provide it. Because in the end, for us, it's about Ignite, coming together with the critical infrastructures, all those teams that build solutions that make all the people happy, so that they are happy to crowdsource, connect them also to the critical infrastructures for whom their work, for whom your work is also helping them to rethink their research questions.
Well, and then we still have today, because we're sitting here right now. And we know the day is almost getting at its end, but still we can talk to you, you can ask us questions afterwards. And Robert, could you please stand up? And we have a great team member with us today. This is Robert. And he is extremely good at drawing. So he's a visual artist. And you had so many purpose-driven dreams when you were standing up and telling us about. And he can help you make a, how should I say, a nice drawing, a nice visualization of your purpose-driven dream, just with talking to you and then sketching. And I know the day almost ends now, so there might be little time, but if you're interested and if you want to get to know our track better and want to get to know more into a deep dive, go and talk to Robert. I actually can show you some little thing that he draw for me today, because I wanted to show you something for the people that are so excited now to join our track.
You've got to make it quick, because we have to go to the main stage.
I just need like one, maximum two more minutes.
One minute. That's it.
Yeah, but I just need one minute. I'm sorry. Because all you people that want to join but don't have a team, we have Tinder with a Purpose. So if you go to nature.squiffer.com, you can make a profile with your photo, your name, your email address, and you can give a motivation of what you want to do and why, and your field of expertise. And if more and more people fill in these profiles, you can actually swipe to nature.squiffer.com. And if you have a match with someone, you will get their email address. And if you get their email address, you can start mailing, and maybe you can team up together and come and applicate together as a team for this hackathon. Well, I guess you guys are already very enthusiastic. So if you want to know more, contact us. And otherwise, I would say, let's build this together.
Thank you.